Hi, I'm Claudia, and today I'm back with the second installment of the Python parentheses tutorial. Specifically, today we're going to talk about square brackets. We're going to look at what we can do with square brackets in Python, the various uses of square brackets, and how to use them correctly. For more in-depth tutorials like this one, go ahead and subscribe to our channel, and be sure to hit that bell too so that you're the first one to know when another video is released. All right, let's get into it. In Python, square brackets are used for three things: for creating and using lists, for list comprehension, and for selecting items, either individual items or slices from a collection, and retrieving items from a collection, whether it's individual items or parts of the collection. Let's take these things one by one. The first thing we're going to look at is lists. Lists in Python are a pretty fundamental data type. They're used a lot. They're very, very useful. You can find a lot of very good applications for lists. To create an empty list, all you have to do is use the square brackets one next to the other, like you see here, open square bracket, close square bracket. In this case, I assigned it to a variable name called empty. And to create a list that actually contains some elements, as you can see here, I use the exact same notation, square brackets open, square brackets close. And in between the square brackets, I add whatever elements I want this list to include, separated by commas. So if I run this cell, I don't get any output because what ended up happening is that Python created these lists and stored them in memory for me. But if I look at each individual list that I created, the empty list looks like an empty list, right? So just a pair of square brackets with nothing in between. And the full list, well, it has the three elements that I included, which is a one, the letter A, and 2.5. Because lists are so common and they're so useful for so many different purposes, you'll get to use these a lot. Now, one nice thing about Jupyter Notebooks is that when I create a list, so let's say that I'm going to create a new list here, if I start typing the open bracket, Python is going to do me one better, and it's going to insert a closed bracket in there as well, just to make sure that I don't forget to close it. So remember, closing your brackets and your parentheses is super duper important in Python. So Jupyter is going to take one step extra for you and automatically close whatever bracket or parentheses you open. So in this case, this would be on its own an empty list, but if you want to insert things here, you can type them out as usual. So again, the fact that closed bracket was also typed when I simply typed an open bracket is a Jupyter feature. So you'll get this in Jupyter Notebook and perhaps some other IDEs out there, but you will definitely not see this in the text editor if that's what you're using for development. Next, we'll move on to list comprehensions. List comprehensions also use square brackets, and they're a very simple way to create a list from another list by iterating through the elements of the other list and without using a full-blown loop. This example here, we're starting out with this list called first, which contains all of these elements from 1 to 9. And we're also starting a second list called second, and this list is empty. Now, in this first example, I'm going to show you how you would do this using a full-blown loop. And right after this, I'm going to show you how to do it using a list comprehension. After we've created these two lists, first and second, we can go ahead and write our for loop for a number num in first, in the first list, so this one right here. If the number is divisible by 2, so if num mod 2 is 0, then I want to append the double of that number to the second list. And otherwise, I just want to append the number. So pretty simple logic. If the number is even, I want to append the number times 2, so double the number to second. And if the number is odd, so if num is odd, then I just want to append num to second. Now, if I run this code, of course, nothing happens because there's nothing to output as a result of this code, but let's see what second looks like. And as expected, second will contain all of the odd numbers from first. So 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. And then for all the even numbers, it's going to contain the number times 2. So the double of the even numbers. Now, for the list comprehension example, how would we do this using a list comprehension? When we use a list comprehension, we still need to define that first list, right? So first is still defined the same way it was up top in the previous example. But when defining the second list, we actually get to smoosh in that for loop right in there and populate that list with the numbers that we want in it at the same time in a single line of code. So in this case, second equals, and we still open the square brackets and close the square brackets here. But then in between the square brackets, we specify our condition, right? So we specify what elements we want in that second list. Specifically, we want the number times 2. So num times 2 if the number is even. So this condition right here means that the number num is even. Otherwise, we just want the number num if num is in first. You notice that in the list comprehension example, the for part of the for loop is added at the end of the condition, right? So first, we specify the condition. We specify what we want in the list if a condition is met. So if this condition is met, we also specify what we want in the list if that condition is not met. And just finally, at the end, we specify, oh, by the way, get these numbers from the list first. So it's still exactly the same logic as we had up top here in the for loop. It's still a for loop, except that it's in a slightly different shape and it's written on a single line. So there's no more indentation or anything like that, like we saw in the for loop, no code blocks. It's all a single line. This right here is a list comprehension. Now, if we run this cell here, of course, nothing happens because we ran a bunch of calculations. But when we run second to see what's in the list, we have the exact same thing as we had up top here. So second, the list contains exactly the same elements in this case as we did when we ran the full for loop in its traditional format, right? So we got the exact same outcome from the list comprehension as we got from the for loop. In short, what is a list comprehension? A list comprehension is just an easy and elegant shorthand, an easy way to create the list from another list via a for loop that is just ever so slightly smooshed together on one line of code. The third use of square brackets in Python is to retrieve items from a collection. Now, we saw lists already, and lists are collections of elements, collections of items. So yes, we do use square brackets to retrieve items from a list as well. But there are also other collections in Python. There are many other collections. Basically, many data types can be considered collections in Python. For example, in this cell here, we have a word, the word banana, which is obviously a string in Python. And a string is itself a collection. It's a collection of other strings. So each letter is a string in itself in Python. We can have a collection represented as a list, which we also saw earlier. So a collection of odd numbers would be 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. And we can also have a dictionary, for example, which is also a collection, even though, as you can see, and as you'll see in the next video when we talk about curly braces, we define a dictionary using curly braces. Nonetheless, a dictionary is in itself a collection. And as we'll see, we still use square brackets to retrieve items from a dictionary. All right, so to access a character inside a string, we use square brackets thusly. Word is the word banana right here that I assigned to the variable word, right? So let's run this cell here. So word now contains the string banana. And if I run this particular line of code, what will I get? Well, I will get the character at index 2 inside the word banana. So what is index 2? If you remember your basic Python, when we start counting indices, we start at 0. So the letter B is at index 0, A is at index 1, N is at index 2, A is index 3, N is index 4, and A is index 5. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and specify. Now, if we go back to this line of code, what do we want? We want the character that lives at index 2. So that would be 0, 1, 2. So we would expect the character n, right, to be returned as a result of running this line of code. And sure enough, it's the character n. So in a nutshell, this is how the square bracket notation is used to get an item from a collection, in this case, a string. Step one, we pick the index of the item from the collection that we want to retrieve. Step two, we put that index in between square brackets that are attached to either the variable name where the collection lives, as is the case here, because we saved the word banana in the variable word, or you could even attach this to the actual collection itself. So for example, if I just wrote the word banana and ran the same line of code, I would get exactly the same result, right? If I wrote a different word here, let's say watermelon, I would get the equivalent result, which is in this case, the letter T, which lives at index 2. So very important, there is no space between the actual collection, right? So in this case, the string that I'm trying to pull an item out of and the square bracket notation for getting said item out. And the same is the case for the variable name. If I want to use a variable name and the square bracket. So absolutely no space in there. Now, when it comes to lists, exactly the same notation applies. Lists are very similar to strings in that respect. We can access items in lists using their index. So in this case, we have the list onNums, which we defined up here, which has the elements 1, 3, 5, 7, and 9. And we can use the equivalent index to get, for example, the first item from this list. So oddNums square bracket 0 close square bracket is going to yield 1 because that is the item at index 0 in the list oddNums. Now going up to the third collection that we had up here, numchar and name, this is a dictionary. So in a dictionary, we have also a number of items. We can have empty dictionaries as well as dictionaries with a number of key value pairs in them. And for dictionaries, we also use the square bracket notation to retrieve items from it. The only difference is that because the elements in a dictionary are not in any particular order, the square brackets don't use an index, right? Because there's no concept of an index in that case, but instead they use the key of a specific key value pair to bring out the value. So in our case, numchar name is the name of the dictionary. We use the exact same notation, open square bracket, close square bracket. And in between, we use the key of the value that we want to retrieve. So if we go back to look at this dictionary, the dictionary contains two key value pairs, John, which has a value of 4, and Sandra, which has a value of 6. If we pick the key Sandra and we run this line of code, we would expect to get the output of 6, which is what we're getting right here. Why is it 6? Well, because in this dictionary, 6 is the value that is attached to the key that is the string Sandra. Outside of getting single values out of dictionaries and lists and strings, we can also get series of values. Getting single values from a collection is not always the most useful. Sometimes we want to get a slice of a collection. Sometimes we want to get, let's say, elements from a starting point through an endpoint, and that way extract an entire part of a string or a list or a dictionary. To get a data slice from a collection in Python, we also use square brackets, but the notation inside the square brackets is a little different. Specifically, we have more than one number denoting the index when we're talking about extracting data from a string or a list. When getting a data slice, we must specify between the square brackets the index that we want to start at, the index that we want to end at, and optionally, we can also specify a step, which is basically the number of data points that we want to skip when getting said slice from the data collection. In between these numbers, we use a colon. So start index, colon, end index, and optionally, another colon and a step index. Let's see an example of what that would look like for a list. In this case, we're going to store the new list in the variable named numbers. And I'm going to generate this list using a list comprehension. So item for item in range 20 is basically a list that includes every single number starting from 0 and going all the way to 19. So if I want to look at what's in numbers, it's of course a list of numbers starting from 0 and going all the way through 19. Now let's get a slice. Let's say I want to access all the numbers between 5 and 15 from this collection of numbers, including 5 and 15, but skipping every second number. So I want to go through this collection and pick out the numbers between 5 and 15, skipping every second number, but including both the start and the end index. To do that, I'm going to have the name of the variable here, numbers, because that's where my collection is stored, open bracket, and of course, close bracket at the end here. And in between, we have the start index, which is 5, the end index, which is 16. The reason why it's 16 is because I want to include the 15th element. So in order to do that, we want to end at index 16 because remember, the element at the end index is not going to be returned. And finally, because we want to skip every second number, we're going to add a step of 2. So I want to get every other item in this collection. And running this example, sure enough, we get the numbers 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, and 15, which is exactly what we were going for. Let's see the same example with letters. In this case, I'm going to start with a list of letters stored in the very creative variable name letters. And here I want to access all the letters between B and H, including B and H, skipping every second letter. Now, this example is identical to the numbers example that we just saw. The only thing that might be a little trickier is the fact that the index for this list are not identical to the items for the list. So in order to get the indexes of the items that we want to extract, we need to do a little bit of counting first. So letter A lives at index 0, letter B, index 1, C, index 2, D, index 3, E is index 4, 5 for F, 6 for G, 7 for H. So now that we know that H lives at index 7 and B lives at index 1, we can go ahead and construct our slice. We have the address of the list, that's the variable name letters. Then we have the open square bracket, and at the end, we have the closed square bracket. The start index, which is 1, the letter B lives at index 1. The end index, which is 8. Why is it 8? Well, because we want to return the letter H, which lives at index 7. We know that Python is not going to return the item at index 7 if we were to use that index here. So we need to use the index after that to ensure that we get that letter H. And finally, the step, which is 2. And voila, we have the letters B, D, S, and H. If you've enjoyed this video, go ahead and click that subscribe button and also the bell. That way you'll also be the first to know when the next video comes out. For even more in-depth tutorials about Python and other AI technologies, go ahead and check out our blog as well. That's going to be at edlitera.com/blog. The link is going to be included in the description as well. Thanks for watching. Come back next time.